Welcome everyone. On behalf of the Stanford Alumni Association of India, Adam and me would love to welcome you today to this very special session. You know, as an alumni club, and you know, several of us are here from Stanford, we try to engage in different conversations, try to figure out what we can do to engage with the community and to really debate out issues which are important. So we thought of putting together an event like this where we can hear from somebody on the ground about her experiences, and Adam will talk about it in a minute. But the whole purpose of this kind of a format is to bring a voice that we can all hear and, you know, again, start a conversation, see how we can be, you know, engaged more in issues like this, and also come up with the right questions to ask. I think that is the spirit of an event like this, is to really get some questions going and to understand what is really happening on the ground today in our own backyard. So I'm going to hand it over to Adam, who's really put together this event with a lot of effort to talk about what we're going to hear from Teesta and why we are doing this event today.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thanks, Paula. And thank you, everyone, for taking the time out of your busy days to come today. You know, the title of today's fireside chat is The State of Human Rights and Justice in India. You know, the concepts like human rights and justice are big and weighty, and they're kind of abstract as well and tough to wrap your head around, which is why, you know, we're so fortunate today to hear from someone who really has, from the ground up, textual experience of what it actually means to either fight these battles, to experience and walk through that process of justice in India. Ms. Teesta Setalvad. Okay. Teesta is a human rights activist, a journalist with decades of experience of first reporting on these incidents on the ground and then fighting these battles now with her NGO, Citizens for Justice and Peace, which was started in 2002 by a group of committed citizens here in Mumbai in response to the riots of Gujarat in 2002. Teesta also has a great Stanford affiliation, which is why Stanford is really happy to put this together. Stanford co-wrote a report on human rights in about 2015, and a lot of the archives from the cases that Teesta has worked actively in are hosted at Stanford. So without further ado, let's begin the discussion. Thank you, Teesta.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everybody, for being here, Paula, Adam, and all of you for taking time out today. You know, when we speak about things like justice, it's such an awesome word, such a motivational word, and for civilizations, for centuries, justice has driven people, motivated people. I mean, Martin Luther King's famous letter from Birmingham jail, the Magna Carta, the Bill of Rights, liberty, equality, fraternity. Closer to home, it's what moved Buddha. It's what drove Mahavir. I think Kabir, Tukaram, Mahadev, Eknath were all witnesses to injustice and spoke against it. So I think there's no civilization that has not craved a foundational commitment to justice. And to create that foundational commitment, you need to fight against injustice. You can't get justice for the asking. It's not an easy path. It requires clarity, commitment, and courage. And therefore, in India, we have the constitutional vision. 70 years, what is our vision? It is what's given to us in the Constitution. The Constitutional Assembly gave it to us. Our Constitution gave it to us. It's the cardinal chapters, Chapter 3 and Chapter 4, which is the fundamental rights and the directive principles. So political rights of equality, non-discrimination, the right to life and right not to have my personal freedom taken away, and very, very importantly, equality before the law. Now, these are the tested principles of our Constitution, and every day we need to assert them, and every day we find them taken away. So that's what this entire journey has meant at an abstract level. Concrete level, I feel it's only individual struggles and nuances and individual stories that make these lofty values actually real. What was amazing for me and so moving was just about less than a week ago when you had Siptatul Rashidi, an 18-year-old boy from Standard 10, just killed out of the blue in Asansol. And his father, who's the imam there, he just did something which Gandhi did in 1946, when Noakhali happened. And what did he do? He told the frenzied, angry people who were so angry over the young man's death. He was just going to become a man. I mean, he was in standard 10. He said, "If you dare to take one step in revenge, I will leave Asansol forever." Now, it is those kind of amazing individual acts that drive meaning to Article 14, Article 15, and Article 21. It's not just the lofty courts. Of course, we have rule of law and constitution, and we need the justice process and the courts to be the sentinels of justice. But, I mean, our experience shows that it doesn't happen on its own. You have to have citizens who stand by the most marginalized communities. Because, I mean, the human rights area is vast. You can human rights on water and environment and all. But when you have a structured society with all kinds of injustices, it's the marginalized and the voiceless who are the most vulnerable. So that's what we try to concentrate on, the most marginalized. So that's what our definition of the minorities is, which is Adivasis, Dalits, of course, religious minorities, the dissenter, the political dissenter, free speech, and finally, criminal justice reform. Because without reform in our justice system, it can't work. It just can't work.
Fantastic. And, you know, Teesta, you just help us give a very kind of high level overview of the different mechanisms of justice. Could we maybe, you know, for us who don't necessarily walk through that process, could you give us a sense of, at a high level, where problems lie? You know, I think oftentimes we think about the mechanisms of justice or the courts, you know, moving in a fairly straightforward, mechanical way, but that's often not the case.
No, the courts don't move unless you move the courts, and you have pendency of cases. Access is very difficult. So, for instance, if you are that last Dalit on the ground who's faced brutal lathi charge, or whose house has been burned, or that Dalit bridegroom who's simply been targeted because he was driving a horse, because our social taboos say that a Dalit can't ride a horse as a bridegroom. Or if you're a Muslim wrongly caught for terrorism. I mean, you had somebody released just yesterday, 15 years of his life gone and not a single pie in compensation paid, and the guilty policeman not punished. So what you need to do is to be able to make that path more accessible. So if you provide intrepid legal aid, which is very difficult, which means you have to handhold the survivor, record the evidence, make sure that it passes certain national and international standards, and then have forbearance, because the process is very long and very exacting. We have people in jails who are just should not be there. We have at least 30% more in our central jails and 60% more people in our district jails than there's capacity to hold them.
Sure. So you're saying that 60% of people who are in prisons are actually just waiting for their case to be heard, not
under
even
trials. They're not
under trials.
Yeah, they're not as if somebody who's been charged cheated. So they're not. Our law tells us that within 24 hours you need to be produced before a court. It doesn't happen. And then among those people are the poor, the marginalized, the woman, the Dalit, the Muslim, the Adivasi, because he or she doesn't have an advocate. He or she doesn't have a group fighting for them. So therefore, we've chosen our four pillars, CJP, which is, we look at the Kashmiri Pandits in the valley. We look at the Sonbhadra Adivasis. We look at Dalits. We, of course, will never lose our focus on religious minorities, because that's where our trial by fire began. And we have women and children. And finally, we look at criminal justice reform, because one of the great contributions of CJP has been to introduce victimology.
What is victimology?
In our system, it's just the state that prosecutes a crime. So if you're a witness, or if you're a family member or a complainant, you can't agitate a case on your own. You have to depend on the state to do it. And the state often doesn't do it right for a variety of reasons. Apathy, lethargy, or compromise, because they're powerful perpetrators. Now, thanks to the Best Bakery case and many cases that we were involved in, there's a section introduced in the CRPC by which an individual complainant or a victim can also assist the prosecution. So you can make sure your case doesn't die.
Fascinating. I think what always helps is that we can try to concretize this in the context of a particular incident. Yeah. So I think we have a video that talks about an incident that recently happened just in our backyard, the Bhima Khorakiwala incident. We'll just play it and then get Teesta to explain it and then walk us through
that
process.
Just New Year's Day this year, actually.
Just New Year's Day this year.
Khorakiwala Bhima Nagar rastyavarti dangal challele asun. Oh!
we in Bombay believe there's no caste, but we don't ask ourselves the question as to who cleans our streets. We don't ask the question, who are the manual scavengers? Why do they only belong to one section of the population? So this was interesting because it was about the contestation of history. It's like black history in America or Aboriginal history elsewhere. For the Dalits, this battle is important, though for many others, they say that it was actually siding with the British, but it was important because the Mahar regiment beat the Peshwas. And the administration and the police and the government knew that they were going to assemble there, that a few lakh people were coming. They should have had enough people protecting the commemorators. But the police was absent so that the goons could turn upon them. And what we did was, we found after that, that there was a series of false cases put on Dalits, almost 4,000 across the state. In Kalyan, there was brutal aggression on Dalits by the Agri Sena, which owes allegiance to the Shiv Sena. So we just helped them record FIRs. We helped them make sure that the correct evidence was recorded. We even went with, you know, leaders like Prakash Ambedkar and all who were trying to broker peace to the Commissioner of Police, Mumbai and Thane, to try and get the police off the back. Because dialogue is also necessary. You can't always do it through confrontation. So correct evidence, this thing. And you know, this is when what happens when you have a marginalized community. Even day before yesterday when the Bharat Bandh was there, the mainstream media said there was violence. Actually, the violence was being perpetrated by the Karni Sena, which was the upper caste Sena against the Dalits who were protesting. So the way we tend to label the role of the media in all of this, and we're all experiencing a very, very compliant and prejudiced media, all of this becomes important to human rights work. So human rights-based journalism is also what something CJP tries to do through its videos and writing.
Sure, sure. I think if you can help us understand, you know, in the context of this specific incident, right, what is the role of the police here? Aren't there a set of principles that, you know, can, yeah, in, at least from a legal perspective, govern the behavior of police to make sure that they're accountable and protect any citizen,
yeah,
every citizen?
If you look at those visuals, they're very interesting for me, because then you can go back one further. This is, the last one is the JNU student. Before that is Radhika Vemula, Najib's mother in Delhi. The JNU students, and all of this happens in the capital city when people are peacefully protesting. These are women and girl protesters, young women protesters. And each time the police, including women policemen, are behaving brutally. So we started looking at this issue, and I looked at the Gujarat police manuals, the Delhi police manuals, the Bombay police manual. And you know, in America, if you get arrested wrongly, you can quote the First Amendment. We can't do that here. We can't quote Article 14, Article 15, and Article 21. If the police starts beating you up, you can't quote a section of the Constitution, because the police does not have it ingrained in them that they have to behave in a particular way.
So there isn't a sort of a law in the books or a case that has some kind of precedent?
We look through all the Supreme Court judgments. We look through all the High Court judgments. There's no pronouncement which says that this is how the police should behave with peaceful protesters. So then we started exploring it with a group of lawyers who's our team, and we are planning to put together international research and actually move the Delhi High Court, Bombay High Court, and maybe one more state to begin the process of an SOP.
So a court can actually outline that level of detail in the procedure for how police should behave in these
sorts
of contexts.
They just did it recently in the POXO cases, you know, when child molestation, yeah, cases, you found the law was being passed, but there was no guidelines. So you found that there was, in the children's homes and in schools, nobody was following a procedure when it came to child molestation cases, sexual abuse cases. So the court did that in Vishakha. When there was a rape case, it's done it in sexual harassment cases, because of which we have sexual harassment committees. So I want to get it, we want to get it done for police behavior. Because I mean, the right of a citizen to protest is just not there with us, except when you have large numbers and you manage the discretion of the administration not to get attacked.
I just want to come in here and ask one question. You know, whenever the media has highlighted an event or an atrocity, whether it's a rape cases or the child molestation cases, that's when action has happened, mm-hmm, whether it's by the courts or by the government or by even groups. Does the media selectively do this under, obviously it does it under some sort of a pressure, but how do you get around to that? Because, you know, the media seems to be controlling so much of this. And my second question is, you know, the police manual not having this, is it a legacy of the British?
Yeah.
And hence we are sort of propagating actually the British legacy?
Very good question. I'll take the second one first, yeah, if you don't mind. We have an Article 372 in the Constitution, which actually enjoined on all our parliaments to constitutionalize all our laws. Because our lofty ideals are contained in the Constitution, but all our laws, including land law, forest law, all of this was actually, like you said, a colonial law, which was actually aiding an oppressive government to control a foreign people. So our police act and the police manuals actually are the 1856 act. And you had a Prakash Singh go to the Supreme Court and get a judgment. He's a retired policeman. To say policemen need reform, the police law needs reform. And the Supreme Court passed the judgment, but no state, not even Maharashtra, has implemented the Supreme Court judgment. So therefore, to get judgments implemented as well requires citizens' action and mobilization. And your first question, yes, it's only when there is an act. See, democracy, media, people's voices is what makes human rights abuses heard. Remember Tiananmen Square? Remember the Bengal famine of 1943 was a colonial government. They hid the fact that 20 million people died in hunger. But when a democracy becomes a majoritarian democracy like we've become, where there's no respect for the rule of law, because I would say this with a lot of pain and regret, that India today is not a real democracy. It's like a majoritarian democracy which is trying to suppress voices, which is trying to infringe on media. I mean, you had this fake news attempt 3 days back, which the minister had to take back. So in this kind of scenario, the media is picking and choosing. And the media is not actually covering human rights abuses as they should, to answer your question.
No, I think
social media is filling a little bit of that vacuum. Yeah. But that may not also be for very long, as we know that Facebook and others are also coming under pressure of governments. But I think the real answer to that is to encourage citizen-based journalism, human rights journalism.
In light of, you know, just piggybacking off of that, you know, living in Bombay, you know, we would get transparency only to the things that the media ends up reporting or the things that are in our most urban backyards. We have a video now coming up of a particular set of issues with forest workers, right? So that, again, I'll ask you to explain thereafter, that maybe lends a little bit of detail and context to a set of issues that we won't see normally.
We won't even know about.
Absolutely.
बोलते हैं कि सीधी तरह आ जाओ नहीं तो अभी आके मजा चकाते हैं इस तरह का जो है पुलिस वालों का रवैया है वो लोग माफिया उनके कहने पर दलालों के कहने पर फोन करते हैं और फर्जी केस काटते रहते हैं
पुलिस वाला मारे गोली चलाया अब वही हमको फर्जी मुकदमा मार लगा दिया जब हम अपना मांग नहीं मांगब अपना हक नहीं मांगब अपना परिचय नहीं देब तो हमरा के पहचान अपना जल जंगल जमीन हम दीदी कुर्बानी हो जाएंगे लेकिन जमीन छोड़ेंगे नहीं
गांव छोड़ब नहीं जंगल छोड़ब नहीं माय माटी छोड़ब नहीं लड़ाई छोड़ब नहीं
Shobha, the one woman who spoke first, and she was raped by eight men because she was fighting for her land. And when I went, the area is Sonbhadra. Sonbhadra is India's largest forest. It spans five states and a very rich forest. And the Forest Rights Act that was passed in 2006 was an acknowledgement that forest workers and Adivasis have protected our forests and the environment. That because they know how to, they both live off the forest, and they also protect the forest. So this act actually gives them the rights over that land, including rights they had before the British took them away, you know, and the Forest Department became a very, very repressive force. But even after the law has been passed, to actually get the land has been patta by patta applications in different districts and different talukas, a painful process. So some of these organizations are fighting for it. And the All India Union of Forest Working Peoples is a CJP partner, whom you saw there. And we are helping them not fight for the land because they know how to do that best, but all these women, 45 of these women have got false cases on them. And one woman, I mean, I have 15 cases false against me. One woman has 8, 9, 10, 12. And every time she has to go to a court, she has to pay 200 rupees by bus to go there. She loses her
driving. Who has filed these wrong cases against these women?
It's the forest department or the police in cahoots with people who want to grab the land.
So it's the state plus some kind of moneyed interest.
Mafia, yeah, the local mafia. So those cases have been filed by us. They're coming up for hearing in June, July, because we are recognized having some experience in negotiating the system when it comes to false cases. And it's real oppression, these false cases, because their daily livelihood is affected, and also they're very vulnerable to the lathi and this. So it's a very real issue that human rights defenders in India, we consider we are also some human rights defenders because we're fighting for rights, tend to get more vulnerable because false cases get put against you, because that becomes a method of the state to prevent you from doing what you're doing. So that's one area, again, which CJP is concentrating on, is helping other human rights defenders negotiate the courts when false cases are filed.
So is that how CJP thinks about sort of scaling its impact? Because I imagine that, you know, a lot of this is a labor-intensive kind of process of trying to move the mechanisms of justice everywhere.
It's the biggest challenge, because to get a decent lawyer, an honest lawyer, who doesn't actually compromise or doesn't delay your case, who charges a reasonable cost and a fee, in a district, in a town, is very difficult. So our ultimate aim is to kind of build up a network of lawyers who are aligned to us, either independent or with us, because we wouldn't have survived in the work we are doing without a very, very committed band of lawyers, right from the districts in Ahmedabad to the High Court in Ahmedabad to Bombay to Delhi and the Supreme Court. I mean, night and day our teams are active whenever there's an attack on us. We need to create this team which is viable for human rights abuse everywhere. It'll be slow, it can't happen overnight everywhere. We'll have to pick and choose. So maybe where the Forest Workers Union is first, where our partners are working first, and then slowly scale up, because we can't start everywhere all of a sudden, you know, there are too many resources, etc.
Sure. I think, you know, because this is a Stanford event, naturally there's the machinations of the mind. We're like, ooh, is there a tech solution, right? Is there a technology-based mechanism by which some of this stuff can scale? Right, I think there's a quick video about one of the projects that CJP is working on that we'll play, and then we can talk about how that, what's the path for that kind of solution.
That's been a dream thing that we've been working on, Javed and I, for years, with all our experience, and we just want to try and see that that comes alive at some point.
Sure, let's see it.
CJP's Peace Map is a unique initiative that aims to track and prevent violence with the help of peace workers on the ground. At the first sign of trouble, our peace workers reach out to a dedicated helpline via IVRS, SMS, and social media. Here, volunteers respond to distress calls, connecting peace workers and local authorities to help stop the conflict. Our aim is to record, predict, and prevent large-scale violence from breaking out. This system has also been awarded a NASSCOM Prize for Innovation. CJP's Peace Map is a direct outcome of our long experience of working in conflict areas and is based on our firm belief that hate hurts, harmony works. Peace Map, towards a violence-free India.
You know, actually it can happen if you spot the rumors in time. If you spot the pamphleteering and the hate mongering in time, if you tap the political visits of certain leaders who tend to provoke the mob, and if at that time a local based mohalla committee and a group of citizens actually starts interacting with the district magistracy and the police. Because today, who's interacting with them? It's only the mobster. The guys who are creating the violence are actually pressurizing them not to act against those who are creating the violence. If there was a group of citizens who found the courage to actually step in when the build-up happens, we really believe that you can actually prevent conflict from breaking out. Communal caste and gender. And for that, you need about 5,000 or 10,000 peace workers on the ground who are connected through the technology.
Sure.
VRS, so, IPS.
So what's the state of the technology now, and what are the challenges with getting it to work and actually making sure that it does exactly what you're trying to say and hopefully prevents conflict?
See, you'll be able to explain the technology better, but I can just tell you that we are using Ushahidi. Ushahidi in Swahili means witness. It's a worldwide program. It's an NGO-based program, and they give their software for free, and they've allowed us their platform. That's where it's conceived. The prototype is already up, but we need to fine-tune it further. What we need really is resources. We need resources and a whole team. So we need people who will man it at our head office. We'll need at least 10, 15 people whom we can give seed money to be actually the workers on the ground. And then we need to do trainings of volunteers to be able to feed the system. But it's ready to go as soon as the resources come.
Okay.
And on the ground, Teesta, you talked about majoritarianism, and obviously we are a country with very many diverse people. Do you find that actually it's not the majority of people who support this kind of human rights violations, or do you find all kinds of volunteers who are willing to be part of this, or is it very split down the middle?
I don't think it's split down the middle, but I think if you remember what Martin Luther said again, that the history will remember not the actions of the bad people, but the silence of the good people. We just have to figure out how to break the silence. I mean, I think people are really, there are enough good people there. And I feel at the local level, if they're linked to a wider enterprise, if they're linked to an enterprise that is making an impact technologically, they'll come out of the fear and link up. Even now we get distress calls every day. This is happening here, this is happening there. On an ad hoc level, one is intervening. If that were to become organized, I mean, I remember 92, 93, Bombay, Sainat, Shahjah Rashid, Nikhil Wagle, Javed, all our homes were like control rooms. We were getting calls all the time. We were not acting like journalists. We were actually behaving like, because the police was not responding, unfortunately, at the time, as we saw. So it is possible if you have a good system in place, connected to the right people. And I think, one of our experiences at CJP and Sabrang has been that there are good policemen too. There are good administrators too. And if you actually can tap and reach out to them, you can actually prevent violence.
And one of the other things, and we talked about this a little earlier, this hate or this apathy or this silence or this fear, it starts in some way from, childhood, from what they see, from what they learn. And is there some work that you're doing with schools or with the ground level to really get these children to be the new citizens who will not be silenced or who will not stay silent?
Yeah, that's our work through COGE, which is the Education for a Plural India program, where we try to get constitutional values, secularism, pluralism, sort of imbibed through a multidimensional approach in middle school, 5th, 6th and 7th. And the experience has been quite wonderful. CRI supported us at one point. At one point it was Oxfam India and all. Now the government is trying to stop access of not just our NGO, but many NGOs to the BMC schools. But we are still doing programs through the year. Like we do the Girl Child program, we do the Republic Day program and stuff like that. And we do teacher trainings, about 20 teacher trainings every year. So I think it's really important that these things start very, very young. That Asansol example, which doesn't leave me night and day, the Imam's example, I compare with his action to with what the central minister said when he said, I'll skin everybody alive. I mean, look at the stark contrast. So, and look at what hate speech can do to a society, and look at what an act of deep compassion and pity and grace can do, So actually it was the Imam who probably stopped the violence there by his act, despite losing his own son. And you have a central minister saying that, I'll skin everybody alive, particularly a person of a certain denomination. So today we are getting hate speech, getting sanctity from the top. And for that also, I think citizens need to speak up.
Sure. I should have mentioned this earlier, by the way. There's going to be extensive Q&A at the end of it, and that's what the pads are for if you have any questions that you want to note down. But we'll pivot slightly from topical focus questions to maybe a bit more about your personal journey in this sort of thing, in that, the personal attacks against you are somewhat famous, and we don't need to get into that, but, it would be great to learn first how you got into this sort of work and what keeps you going over the years and motivates you in spite of whatever adversity, either in the execution or in the actual facing of persecution yourself.
It's a tough question. I mean, how we got into this work, a lot of it, when Bombay 92, 93 was a kind of turning point when I say we, I mean Javed and I, when we quit our in mainstream journalism and started Communalism Combat, and then a year later we started COGE, which is an education program. And then CJP was 2002, and actually we have our wonderful trustees here, Nandan Cyrus, and of course Tezun has been a great supporter. But the fact that for us, CJP, the people who came together for CJP had also been singed by 92, 93 Bombay, at what had happened then. The fact that we felt that let's test the courts to see whether we can ever get justice. And so CJP then took 68 cases and fought them right from the bottom to the top. So what keeps going, I think the fact that you can have fellowship and support is very important. I don't think we could have done this alone. Fellowship and support came not just from the trustees and all, but from a wonderful team of lawyers. I mean, amazing team of lawyers. I mean, even with what we've been through in the last 1 week, with one more false case against us, if that team of lawyers had not worked day and night, I mean, all of Sunday we were at their office, right till 9 p.m., we moved the anticipated bail on Monday. We got it only today. But the fact that that team of lawyers is virtually like your own lawyer, I mean, six of the lawyers there. I mean, you can't do this kind of work without that kind of trust, that equation. And if we can expand that to a larger body of human rights defenders and activists, it would be wonderful, you know, it would really be wonderful.
So how do you think your experience is either emblematic or not of how anyone else in this space experiences persecution and adversity in trying to do this kind of work?
See, one lesson I've learned is that the system doesn't want you to continue the fight. The system wants you to give up. The system is okay with one or two articles written, one or two demonstrations, one or two brilliant research papers. But they don't want you to fight a case. They don't want the perpetrator punished, because that means you're stretching the system and seeking answers from it as to why can't you protect? Why aren't you doing what you're supposed to do? So the test is that any activist who wants to take it, push the envelope, fight the good fight till the end, will suffer the way we've been made to suffer. And that's the cost you pay. So I think today that consciousness can be created among citizens who support human rights, that for the good fight to continue, you need to have a sustained band of human rights defenders who can carry the fight to the end. And having said that, one thing that really doesn't make me feel very happy, but is a reality, is that because of my class and my background and my pedigree, I think I'm still standing. If I was not from the background I was in, I probably would have been finished a long time ago. And that's not a nice and happy feeling to have.
Sure.
Yeah. You talked about your pedigree. I just want to ask about, being a woman in this space, and you're fighting really powerful people. How has that experience been? You think it would be any different for a man? In the same situation.
I found the most courageous human rights defenders to be women, but I'm not making a fetish of that. No, I think there are issues that come up. I mean, the things that you have to face because you're a woman, particularly in our society, which is very structured, very patriarchal, doesn't really like the fact that you can have an assertive voice, a non-compromising voice, who's also a woman's voice. And there are particular dangers you face. So among the kind of threats that one has got in life, there's always be sexual abuse and there'll be gendered violence that one is threatened with. I've been physically attacked 5 times, but, you know, these things happen. So it is a particular risk that you face as a woman. And that cannot be taken away, you know. And particularly the powers that we do not like, a certain ideology that they represent, they certainly don't like strong, assertive women.
So clearly the life of someone on the front lines is fraught with any number of personal risk. But for, you know, the people in the audience, for us as normal citizens, how does one try to get involved? How does one try to get informed and try to be engaged and be part of any number of the solutions that can be to the problems that we're facing in this area?
See, I mean, when Amnesty grew, and Amnesty today is like a worldwide movement, and everybody feels quite proud to become a member of Amnesty and support it. I mean, if we were to conceive of something like that nationally, because the kind of attacks on us, like you rightly said, no, there are attacks on FCRA, you can't get funding from abroad, this and the rest. The most viable way to continue this work is to have a large donor base, which is spread out, so that the moment you're large and spread out, you're not vulnerable. And that can be from the small, middle to the large donor. And if that donor base is spread across the country, which shows both monetary support and also membership.
That's quite non-traditional, right? Because in India, we have our 2% CSR law. So I imagine corporates shy away from areas of controversy.
Corporates would not even like to give for education for human rights. Forget fighting for civil rights. They prefer to give it for very soft issues because they see themselves as vulnerable. The government can be vindictive. And CSR is a huge problem at that level. So I think we really need to look at a large body of individual and collective donors who can see such projects through. And also, you know, the fact that you can see through a CJP-like platform, you can see a host of partners on the ground, whether it's the forest workers or whether it is the Dalit organizations, somebody you may not be able to connect up with directly, but you can see that this organization is a platform for so many partners.
Well, hopefully conversations like this and discussions like this are a platform for many more of us to get involved, get engaged, and find different ways to be a part of the solution. Yeah. Thank you so much, Teesta, and we'll move on to the Q&A part of the evening. Are there any questions that anyone would like to... We have a mic going around.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah. Okay. I had a question around your opinion on the recent Supreme Court judgment on the dilution of the SC-ST Act. And given that the reason they said for that was a lot of false claims and the fact that, you know, people couldn't get anticipatory bail, etc.
You know, I'm sure you know already that the bench that gave this judgment also diluted 498A of the IPC, which is the act that is used to kind of register domestic violence cases. And the reasoning was the same, that women misuse that law. So I'm quite upset by that judgment, because there's another legal issue here, which is that under Article 141 of the Constitution, you know, can two judges of the Supreme Court overturn fundamental law like this? Should it not be at least 3 to 5 judges, because you need a wider judicial mind? We've had a set of laws since the 80s, you know, whether it's the SCST Act, whether it's the dowry law, whether in the last 10 years of UPA, you had the Forest Rights Act, the Right to Information, which actually are laws which seek to give civil, economic, and political rights, and also to seek historical redressal for wrongs, you know, like the caste system. Now, for somebody who's a Dalit and an untouchable, and 16.1% of that population, to experience a certain kind of exclusion, you need certain enabling laws, which is why this law was conceived. We first had the Civil Rights Act in 55, didn't work. Then you had the 89 Act, which was finally amended in 2015. So I personally believe that it was not a very temperate decision of the Supreme Court. Because in any case, even under the existing law, you had no, virtually a pathetic level of recording of FIRs and virtually no convictions.
We all know the last few years, the present government certainly has gone after not only you, but all activists and NGOs in general. But is it this government or this BJP particularly, or are all politicians basically same and they don't like a civil society acting against the government?
Very good question. Actually, you know, we had a very dark period in the past as well, and my first activism came at that time, 1977, when the emergency was lifted. And I remember my father telling me that don't worry about, I was in standard 10, he said, forget about your exams, go and campaign against the Congress Party. So Bombay made sure that all 6 seats went to the Janta. I don't know if you remember at that time. And we were on the streets with Bhatkal and Popular Prakashan, putting posters and making sure that the Janta wins. So, and you had political prisoners then. You had vindictiveness then. But honestly speaking, if you compare even that vindictiveness to what's happening today without the declaration of emergency, you could actually have the weighing scale quite even, you know. That's the scary part, that without even the declaration of emergency today, you have the misuse of investigating agencies, the misuse of all sorts of agencies of the government to try and stifle dissent. Not to speak of what happened to my very dear friend. Today is 5 months since Gauri Lankesh was shot dead, 5th of September last year, you know. And simply because she was expressing a view, she was a brave journalist in Kannada. Before that, you had Kalburgi. Before that, you had Pansari and you had Dabolkar. And it's shocking that Maharashtra, which is known to be a progressive state, had 2 of those killings, and Karnataka 2 others. So I think there is a particular vindictiveness in this regime, which was not even there in NDA-1, which is the same ideology. It was a minority government, maybe because it was a minority government, it still had the RSS ideology behind it, but it was not so vindictive. But I think there is a vindictiveness in this regime which can be tracked. Quite apart from us, look at the way they're treating students. JNU, HCU, Pondicherry University, Assam University. We are part of a tribunal where 700 young minds have criminal cases against them. I mean, is this how you treat your future citizenry, who's just questioning, who's agitating? And I think you should glory in the fact that young people are agitating, because they are celebrating democracy. So the way they're kind of destroying JNU bit by bit tells you how vindictive this regime can get. I really believe this. They are a particular shade of vindictiveness.
The others are not going to learn from them and do the same if they ever come to power.
Well, I hope not, but which is not to say anything can happen if we are quiet about it. I mean, we really have to speak up even about what's happening now. And we know what happens to people on social media and Twitter when they speak up, on Facebook when they speak up. But I also know that despite that, people are speaking up from every corner of mind. There's not, I mean, I'm out of Mumbai 25 days of a month. And there's no part of India that I go to which is not agitating at this point. But the fact is there's no coordination, there's no synchronicity. The media is not doing its job, so we don't know about it.
Teesta, you explained that the whole process of filing an FIR or going to the court is extremely cumbersome and difficult. Is there any attempt being made to simplify it so that it's accessible to citizens who are even not literate or educating them in any yeah. any
we just way. we need to get there. I mean we don't have a solution right now, but we need to get there. We were part of an experiment once with the Delhi government, in the earlier government in Delhi, when they tried to get some women's organizations involved whenever there was a gender assault on women and children. They had a list of 20 organizations whom they would call upon, so that before the FIR is registered, the correct sections are put, the correct facts are put, and it's not, because the manipulation starts with the FIR. So what we need to do is actually do that in every city with every government. That for all sensitive cases, gender cases, Dalit cases, Adivasi cases, minority cases, make sure there's a witness. Make sure there's a person from civil society, because the police is not going to automatically change overnight. You need to make this process happen. So we need to work towards that as well.
The second question I have is, of course, in the past, the political parties have played the whole game of divide and rule dramatically, and that probably is one of the causes of the hatred and non-inclusiveness. Have you reflected upon what is really causing this hatred, non-inclusiveness? Is it greed? It's just apathy? Or what is really behind it?
At this point, I feel that the hatred and non-inclusiveness is legitimized by a nearly 100-year-old organization, which has worked systematically to come to power at the center, which is the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. So I think the political space that they've slowly captured is because of that organizational space increasing, lot of discipline, lot of hard work, and they've got there. Okay? But the fact that some of that hatred echoes in many of us, the fact that that hatred doesn't also affects other people who are not part of that family or that ideological family, is a question that we need to raise for ourselves. The question that Paula raises, what kind of education we have, how do we understand each other's faiths, how do we understand each other's practices, do we believe in dialogue? I mean, I had a former DGP of this state, Sanjeev Dayal, a very fine gentleman. I was doing an interview with him once, and he told me that, Teesta, what has happened to this city of yours? So I said, sir, you are the DGP of Maharashtra, not me. So he said, but I'm from Delhi. So I said, what makes you so nostalgic? He said, you know, when Eid happened, the milk would go from our house to my neighbor's house and Sevaiya would come back. He said, now in Varsova and you, people are not looking at each other. There's so much venom in the air. Now this is something we'll have to deal with ourselves, no? We'll have to have conversations about it in our buildings, on our streets. There'll be no messiah magical solution to this. We have to ask ourselves, why have we come to this pass?
Teesta, you know, I'm a great admirer of yours, and I've always wondered, what is it within you that keeps you going?
Friends like you. I don't know, maybe just an obstinate desire not to give up, and at least not give up unless one absolutely has to. I mean, and it's not that I don't feel fear. I do feel fear. I do feel anxiety. But I just believe that the conversion of that fear into action rather than paralysis is what keeps me going. I would hate to be quiet about something. I would hate not to act about an injustice. I've been lucky in terms of the way I was brought up by my parents. My father and mother were always encouraged argumentation and confrontation and questioning. Very good friends always. I mean, a partner that I couldn't have a better one. I mean, Javed, who's constantly huge support, my children's sister. But I think eventually just the feeling that you shouldn't give up, should not give up whatever happens. And also I think the feeling that one is not doing any wrong, one is doing right. One has not done any wrong. You know, one sure. is actually think one thinks, really believes that one is fighting for what is right.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
You know, this business of witnesses turning hostile, which has become an absolute farce, as epitomized by this Justice Loya case going on, 45 out of six, whatever the number is. So what are international practices? I mean, how can we prevent this? Because it's becoming an absolute joke.
You know, in fact, we experienced it. CJP experienced it firsthand with the Best Bakery case. Because when Zaira came to us, because we had, it was the Citizens for Justice and Peace that brought out the Concerned Citizens Tribunal on Gujarat. And for any of you who have not read that document, I would really urge you to read it. It's one of the finest documents on the carnage. So one of the major cases that took place was the Best Bakery case. And Zaira was one of the witnesses who had turned hostile in Baroda when the trial was heard there. And the trial was concluded in 21 days in Baroda. And everyone was acquitted. And then something bit at her conscience and she wrote to us and she came over. We had that historic press conference. Then we went to court. At that time, Supreme Court for the first time went into international practice and law and saying that witness protection needs to be implemented. You have a different program in South Africa. Canada has a different program. New Zealand has a different program. America takes it to American heights by taking you to different cities, changing your identity and all. I don't think you can ever do that here. But we need to have a proper witness protection program. Without a witness protection program, you're absolutely right. It's not just the Sohrabuddin case is the most scandalous. But in even rape cases, even in dowry cases, parents turn hostile when their child has been killed. Because the trials take too long. The prosecutors in cahoots with the police, there's pressure that, you know, just give up. And you must have time-bound trials and you must have witness protection, you know. And we need to have a witness protection program which will be in sync with our culture and our community. It doesn't uproot you completely, you know, because otherwise people will not be able to handle it. But we simply need to have a witness protection program.
So I think one of the things you briefly touched upon was mobilizing the youth. And regarding that, one question I kind of had was, like, in the United States right now, you're seeing a lot of kids take to the streets, mostly in the high school, like the teenagers stuff. Yeah, exactly. So, and like, having lived in India for a few months now, I've rarely seen any of the teenagers talk about politics or social reform and all these things. So I was just wondering if you have any like thoughts about how that can happen, how that conversation can get started.
It's a tough one because we are a very age prejudiced society, you know. I mean, even the most liberal of us tend to be very, very this thing when we privilege age and this thing over youth and youthful questions and rebellions. So, and you know, you might earlier had children coming to Gandhi Jayanti programs and anti-nuclear programs. I'm sure if you did that today, they would say that you're manipulating children because the nuclear way is the only way to go. So it's a long haul. And in fact, one of the things that's happening in our universities today, and I'm sure you know, JNU, Hyderabad Central University, the Rohit Vemula killing, is this rebellion, you know, which has actually been possible because those universities are independent and they are generating free thought. But at the level of schools, etc., we really have a long way to go because we actually, regiment our kids. We are worried about their safety when it comes to the private schools. In terms of the public schools, the government won't allow it. Because the government controls the BMC schools and won't allow activities like that. So it's certainly something worth thinking about, but it can't happen without some structural, changes and attitudinal changes.
Mine is more of a comment. I'm a JNU alumni. I was at JNU while this was happening, so it's more to just tell people and talk about it. And it's more like a multi-pronged attack, like how you say they stop FCRA funding for NGOs, they stop funding to the university, so the students haven't received stipend for a year, and there's like it's attacking it from all ways. And about this youth conversation, it's actually a lot of it is there in Delhi. It's not there in Bombay, so you don't feel it. But it's Bombay is like there's nothing here, but it's very active in Delhi. And at JNU, it's a lot, and the students are like still fighting. And the biggest fear is that hopefully, if and when the government changes, this shouldn't continue because they've already stopped funding. They've already stopped a lot of things at JNU, and hopefully, like now 2 years have passed, they haven't admitted a single new student at JNU. So hopefully, maybe that should not continue.
You're sure the government's changing, right?
Must
you sounded so confident, I was so relieved.
Must never lose hope. At least that's how we feel in JNU.
You've been an inspiration to us. I must say hats off to all of you. The way you fought the battle, not just you, your teachers. The JNU TA has really stood by the students, hats off.
And they've been, like, they would fought also.
Absolutely.
There's no support from actually.
I know.
There's media, out of the question, there's media
I'll only add one more thing to that. HCU is also fighting a very good battle. It's just that HCU is not so much in the public eye. I go there very often. Yeah. Yeah. 25,000 scholarships have been cut by this government every year. So in the last 4 years, they've cut over 1 lakh scholarships in higher education institutions, what she's talking about, which go essentially to your Kanaiya Kumar and your Jignesh Mevanis. And when I say that, I mean that bright minds who are not from privileged background like ours, who can question structural discrimination like we will never be able to, will be denied good higher education because of the policies of this government. It's scandalous.
So going off of that same topic, actually, as an educator, I'm on the other side of it. So what do you think I should be teaching my students to prepare them for, you know, this structural change we are slowly trying to implement? And what should I be making them aware of?
That's a lovely question. We did these 3 little books which we have for standard 5, 6, and 7 with different modules in Coach, which it's me, mine, and ours. It's my world and the world around me. We'd be very happy to share it with you. It's like 56 modules, which we do, 54 modules every year. It's trying to teach values like equality, non-discrimination, constitutional values through the modular approach, so that you do it through experiments, through interviewing in communities, through engaging with communities. I'd be very, very happy to share that with you. You teach for India, no?
Yeah. Thank you.
You have a question here?
Hello? Hi. I have an intentionally broad question. So you talk about justice, you know, through the entire talk. I'm wondering about your opinion about the power of the judiciary to keep the executive in check in India and how effective it is today, given everything.
See, that's one thing I left out. 12th of January was such a historic day when you had 4 judges of the Supreme Court coming out and actually saying that something is wrong in the top court, you know. And one would have expected after they did that, that there would be really some huge churning that would take place, even publicly, in terms of the media, in terms of discussion and debate. It did not happen. And that's quite a and that probably tells us where we are vis-a-vis the media. But having said that, I still believe that there is a fair amount of independence in our courts, fair amount. It's not the ideal situation, but the problem is that the offside, the other side is that it's judges who appoint judges, okay? Which is also not the best way it should be, ideally speaking, you know, in any society, because you then tend to get more and more inward looking, you know, that it's well known. So actually you should be having a more robust system with a, you know, national judicial authority or commission, which has got eminent citizens, people, sociologists, political science. But the kind of NJSC that this government wanted to put in place obviously would have been hugely problematic, so which is again why the Supreme Court ruled against it. So I think we need to raise questions about the judiciary also as citizens. You know, and I feel this is something which the media is not doing, but we can do it as citizens. What is the judiciary's attitudes towards prison rights? What is the judiciary's attitude towards death penalty? Why is there such a seesaw all the time? What is the judiciary's attitude, say, towards the SCHC Act or towards dowry? I mean, I hate to say it, but I can't have my Supreme Court Chief Justice move around saying, I gave 16 lakh of dowry for my son, my daughter, which he did. I don't want to name him. Now, you can't have him then looking at the dowry law, right? So this is where we are. You know, this is where we are. This is the kind of society we are. And when I say this, my friends, my advocate for human rights friends in Chicago will tell me, Teesta, we are 200 years ahead of you. We also went through the same thing, which is true. Martin Luther King in the 60s had to fight for the first 5 rows of the bus. So it's a democracy is a project in the making. We are still 70 years. But to make that better things happen, to make 16.1% of our Dalits be in the judiciary, is not asking for reservation. It's asking for pluralism and diversity. Because I want that section represented. I want the working class judge to be there. I would like to have more women there. I would like to have Adivasis and Muslims and Christians there. You can't be not asking these questions because we are a diverse society. That diverse society must be reflected in our structures of governance, including the judiciary. So to answer again, a very long answer I gave you is that it is reasonably independent, but this government is doing everything to influence it, everything.
Rajiv had a question.
I just two quick mini question follow-ups, if I may, and then I swear to pass it on. So do you think the executive has respect for judicial decisions that are passed? Because fundamentally, you know, there's a sort of trust contract that when someone says something, someone else will obey. And do you think that happens often enough? And then two, do you think the judiciary is interpreting the law as the law is written? Or is it, because there's, you know, as there's a lot of examples of where, you know, it almost is arbitrary sometimes in how they choose to adjudicate certain things. Sorry, that may have been a comment.
Does the executive or the executive go by what the judiciary dictates? Not on fundamental issues. We've had D.K. Basu since the 1998 judgment, which said that once an FIR is registered, I have the right to have a copy in the language of my choice. I'll never get that. It tells the police station to put up the list of all the FIRs which has registered every day in a blackboard outside the police station so that nobody can be wrongly incarcerated. Doesn't happen. That's different governments. It's not just this government. So the point is, in terms of implementing judicial directives, we are infamous for not doing it. But when it comes to individual cases, there have been protections. Like Binayak Sen got bail finally from the Supreme Court. We have been protected repeatedly through anticipatory bail by the courts, you know. So there will be individual cases where the judiciary does step in and makes a huge difference. And in the Gujarat cases, we've had a tremendous example compared to other cases of mass crimes, because we've had 172 convictions, 124 to life imprisonment. We did not ask for death penalty on principle, which was also hugely rewarding, because we talked to the survivors and we had discussions, and we said, we don't want retributive justice, we'd like to talk about reformative justice, and that was hugely salutary, you know. So, but that is a rare occasion that has happened. It didn't happen in 84, it didn't happen with the Nelly massacre in Assam in 1983. So, our experience is that you really have to have a very rigorous body of citizens giving legal aid to make justice a reality. It doesn't happen on its own, unfortunately.
We'll take that one last question from Rajiv. Yeah. Fortunately, we have a nice, you know, hour and a half long dinner and drink session where everyone can ask everyone as many questions as you like, but we'll take one more in this forum.
So I'm curious, you know, how do you organize for change in India? So 2 weeks ago, I marched in the March for Lives rally in San Francisco that took place, and there were hundreds of thousands of others around the world who were participating. Yeah. How do you do that in India so that people feel comfortable going out and participating in causes for change? So that's my first question. And the second question relating to that is, how do you protect journalists who want to speak out?
Well, journalists, you protect the same way as right to information activists. We're trying to get information about wrongdoing and don't get protected. You know, we had three journalists being killed in the last 3 weeks alone in India. And it's a very vulnerable situation to be in, particularly if you're out of the metros, out of the camera, and out of the lens of the urban elite. We just have to have a more active citizenry and an active voice coming out from every city saying, this cannot happen. There's no other shortcut to it. I mean, whether it's journalists being attacked, whether it is minorities being attacked, whether it's Afrazul being lynched, or whether it's Una happening in Gujarat, we need to have an active body of citizens that says no. Like when Junaid happened, there were these Not In My Name protests in every city. I don't know if you know about it. When that Junaid Khan incident happened last June, there were these protests for a month in every city, and they were pretty powerful. The problem is they happened and then they went away. We need to keep the momentum going. So it's not that there have been no protests in India, certainly not of the scale that the United States has seen, which makes me feel quite bad about India, that we should have had the protest the day this man was sworn in as Chief Minister, as Prime Minister, but we didn't have that protest like we had when Trump came. But still, the fact that you had it after Junaid's killing, Not In My Name protests in maybe 16 to 20 to 25 cities, is something that I think you should build on. But I think one of the things is what we really need to work on is the middle class and the elite being convinced to come out of their comfort zones. Because that has happened in America. They're coming out. I think here they need to be kind of given the reassurance, made to say that they have to step out of their comfort zone. And that walking the path, walking a protest, walking on a march is not something that you should not be doing, not beneath your dignity, but something we have to do because we have to reclaim that space. I think that's the big difference between America and here, or the West and here. The elite and the middle class don't really feel it's their job to be doing marches. JNU can do it, or some madcap activist can do it, but not us.
And
a month after Gauri Lankesh died, there was a one-month remembrance meeting on Marine Drive. And for the city of Bombay, there were like 200 people.
Yeah.
It was just such a shame. 200, maybe 250 at the most. And a lot of them were...
From this room.
No, not from this room, sadly. But I think Anand Patwardhan or something, you know. I mean, there were sort of groups, maybe. So maybe ordinary citizens, maybe 100.
Maybe.
I mean,
Anand
that's
is
Bombay.
Not an ordinary. He's a good friend. Don't call him not an ordinary.
No. I mean, there was some sort of organized. There were some organized groups, yeah, you know. Yeah, so yeah. 2-3 organized groups, and maybe 100 people.
No, we need to ask ourselves this question: is why our public culture for protest is so weak? I think we really need to ask ourselves this question.
And I think hopefully, you know, this conversation sets a bit of a platform for all of us. In terms of just our understanding of the lay of the land, and you know, you've laid out also a lot of areas where solutions are apparent,
yeah,
and where a little better investment of time, energy, altruism, and focus can go a long way.
You know, Anuradha, who runs this lovely, thank you, Anuradha, who runs this lovely setup. She was saying that we should have more of these conversations on these issues, not just about things. And I was telling her that maybe we can have conversations with some of our defenders, that we actually get the Adivasi women who are fighting. And you have Sheetal Sate who sings, and people who are actually from the ground who can give a flavor of actually what is happening on the ground. And I think it's very important to continue to have such conversations. And thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for helping us make this hopefully the beginning of a lot more of this kind of dialogue. Thank you, Teesta.
Thank you.